traditionally, shipping is a little conservative and old-fashioned and not so good at picking up new technologies. But I think the curve is getting steeper and things are moving faster and faster.
Welcome to the Shipping Podcast, where I meet interesting maritime professionals sharing their passion for the shipping industry and their everyday job. I am your host. My name is Lena Gothberg. Hello, Shipping Podcast listeners, and welcome to the 158th episode of the Shipping Podcast. This is the podcast where you hear me talk with maritime professionals about the maritime industry, where we are and where we are heading. If you're here for the first time, hit the subscribe button and become part of the tribe that gets to listen to the Shipping Podcast as soon as it is released. Now you're about to listen to one of the more visible role models in our industry. I had the pleasure of interviewing Captain Thomas Lindegaard Madsen last week. He's a master mariner who has been sailing for almost 30 years. He has experience from almost everything floating on water. He has sailed everything from a small dinghy to the absolute largest container ships. And he loves his job. It is with great pleasure that I share this chat with you. Welcome to the Shipping Podcast. Could you please introduce yourself?
Yeah, thank you very much. My name is Thomas Lindegaard Madsen, and I'm a captain in Maersk. And I'm 48 years old, and I live in Copenhagen. And normally, I'm the captain of the VENTA MAERSK ice class vessel, feeder vessel trading in the Baltic Sea. And I've been sailing for almost 30 years now. I started as a cadet for another company called J. Lauritsen in 1992. So that's this month, 29 years ago.
Wow.
Yes.
How did you decide to go to sea?
Well, I've been sailing since I was a child. My parents have always been sailing, though they were farmers. They had a sailing boat. So I grew up sailing and I had my own little optimist dinghy. So already at the age of 8, I was my own little captain and did regattas. And in my family, we always prioritized traveling and seeing other countries. So that combined, I love to sail and I love to travel. So when I graduated from high school and had to find out what education to choose, I looked around and then I saw it wasn't my intention. I wanted to study law school or something more fancy. But then I saw this education where you could sign up as a cadet and you would get to see the world. You would get an education and you would get almost a contract with a company already. So I decided to go and then to see where it would bring me. And at that age, you don't know what is going to happen, and it doesn't have to be for the rest of your life. But I just went for the adventure that had part of an education in it. So that was what took me, and I'm still here.
So did you get to see the world?
Yes, I did. I did. And I have been almost everywhere. And there are times where you don't see anything, where you are on board for a couple of months without having the possibility to go ashore or doing sightseeing. But through the years, there are opportunities where the vessel is delayed when you're signing on or when signing off. Or so suddenly you have a day or two or an extra overnight in a foreign country. So yeah, through the years, I have seen a lot.
And you have been on different kinds of ships then, I understand?
Yes. Yeah, in my first company, J. Lauritsen, that was reefer vessels. That was traditional reefer vessels, not reefer containers, but fruit and meat on pallets. So that was with cranes and tween decks, but still very modern ships at that time. And in Maersk, it has, of course, been container ships. I have also had one trip on a tanker as a cadet. Laursen also had tanker ships.
But you have been on different sizes of ships now, I understand.
Yes.
I mean, I'm following you on social media, so I see what you do.
Yeah. As a cadet, I was on one that the smallest was 100 meters. And yeah, the largest I've been is the 400 meter Tripoli.
And now it's a feeder vessel.
Yeah, now it's a feeder vessel. The VENTA MAERSK is 200 meters long. So that's like, to me, that's average. But in some places, it's very big.
And you're trading, what is your trading area for that one?
We are doing Baltic Sea. So that is Gdansk, St. Petersburg, Kotka in Finland. And then we go to Bremerhaven and Wilhelmshaven in the North Sea, and also Felixstowe in the UK. So that is our trade pattern at the moment.
I saw some photos of some ice the other day.
Yes.
It's a lot of ice now.
It's quite exciting. There's a lot of ice now. It has been building up. And now in March, I think, is the thickest ice in the Gulf of Finland and the Bay of Bosnia. And that is what the VENTA MAERSK is built for. It's an ice class 1A, which is the highest class. So it manages quite well, though it is a little challenging. And to us seafarers, we are educated not to bump into anything at all. And then when you have to sail in ice, something different than just the water, it's a bit scary in the beginning, but also a little fun when you get to it.
I have friends who are sailing on the icebreakers, and they are celebrating right now because this is what they love, the ice situation.
Yes, finally, because last year there was not so much ice at all. So we were all waiting for it, but this year there is.
So you have been a captain since 2011, I understand?
11, yes. So that's also 10 years ago now.
Time flies.
Yes, I keep saying that I'm still a new captain, so how do I do this? How do I do this? But then I try to remember myself so much you cannot claim that anymore.
So what are the biggest changes that you have seen in the maritime industry?
I think it's the internet for me. And in fact, I've been asked that question before. And when I think back when I started as a cadet, a lot of the same technology was already available in 1992, which we have now. The ECDIS was already there. It was possible. And GMDSS was just there already. Only the AIS is something that was implemented throughout, but the technology was already there. So I don't think there are that many big changes technologically wise, except from the previous years when internet has become available on board. And of course, the email and the crew, the possibility for the crew to go on the internet, but also with a lot of other opportunities that the internet brings for connectivity of a lot of equipment. And I see that escalating now on board the vessels. A lot of sensors that are online, reefer containers are transmitting automatically to the customers. A lot of things happening and a lot of opportunities that we cannot even think of now. But it has also shortened the distance between sea and shore. Between people, the seafarers and their families and friends at home, the ship management and the office management. And what we see now is that the ship and the shore is also doing Zooms meeting, Teams meetings, because we cannot meet physically or do officers seminars or just go to the office and have a meeting. So in my company, we are starting to do Teams meetings where you have some officers and some managers. So it's really shortening the distance and things are happening.
That's good, I think.
The more the better. And you save a lot of emails by just meeting 5 minutes like we do now, and things happen faster.
Maybe we should talk a little bit about the people who have been suffering from the pandemic. I mean, there is a crisis going on for all the seafarers.
Yes, that has been a big topic and big influence for the past year now. And unfortunately, there's still a lot of people suffering from the effects of the coronavirus around the world and all the restrictions that are in place for all the countries. But fortunately, things have improved, or at least in Maersk, or we have find ways to work around to make crew change happen. But it's still extremely challenging because the situations change every day, and each crew change case has to be handled individually, and it's very difficult for the office ashore, but also for the captain on board, who has to deal with the people on board, but also how to manage flight tickets, local authorities, testing, everything. It's really complicated.
Yes, it is. And also the people who are at home and are not able to reach their vessels and to be, you know, earning an income.
That can be, yes, just as big a problem. But yeah, in my company, we have tried to find solutions for that also, because we would like to maintain connections to our good people and make sure that they come back and help everybody. It's for the good of all.
I'm so impressed by the seafarers. I mean, they are the unsung heroes, and they have just been continuing to deliver what the rest of the society is expecting, more or less. We haven't seen those interruptions in the supply chains yet. They will probably come, but not yet. But in a way, I think it's our own problem that we are just delivering and delivering and delivering, so no one will see the problems.
Yes, I agree, because this is what we do. And as seafarer, we are used to come on board, we work and work and work, we go on watch, we sleep, we eat, the vessel is moving, we are busy. And what happens ashore, we don't really think of or see. We do what we have to do on board. So, yes, it's maybe, but then we can only hope that this will create more visibility of what we are doing.
Yeah. Were you on board or were you at home when the pandemic hit?
I was at home when it hit. So I was stuck at home last year until it suddenly became possible again to, in the beginning, we went by car to Germany and then signed on in Bremerhaven. It wasn't able to fly yet, but the Danes, we could go by car to Germany.
So there was something good with being a Dane.
Yes, at that point, yes.
So moving forward, what do you think about the future in general for shipping moving forward?
I think that the evolution is, the speed is increasing of new technologies. Traditionally, shipping is a little conservative and old-fashioned and not so good at picking up new technologies. But I think the curve is getting steeper and things are moving faster and faster. And especially with the internet and connectivity. And now, yeah, the next thing is decarbonization. That will be the next big thing happening, as I see it. Some people have been discussing vessels without people on board or totally digitalized. It's like nobody's really talking about that anymore. And I don't see it as a big thing. Maybe small barges somewhere on a river, yes, but bigger vessels, I don't see it. There are other things that will come faster than that.
It may be like support from shore, like not remote control, but remote support maybe.
Yes, definitely. People are, it's already possible for some service technicians to log on to the ship network and see things. And there has also been remote pilotage has been tested in some places around the world with success. So yeah, things being done remotely without people coming on board.
How many people are there in your crew? I mean, when you are on board the Ventura?
Around 22, 23. And that's like standard. It doesn't matter whether it's a big vessel or a smaller vessel.
I was just thinking about getting along with 22 people. I hardly get along with myself. So how's that?
Yeah, but in fact, it works quite well. And as you probably know, we are a lot of different nationalities, maybe 7 or 8 different nationalities within these 20 to 23 people. And it works quite fine, I believe. Everybody is a little bit different. And we are all in the same boat and have to do our job. And then at the meals, we talk about our different cultures and backgrounds. So everybody is quite good at getting along, I believe.
Captain Thomas, you are a role model. I mean, you have so many followers on Instagram, on your official Instagram account.
Yes. Yes, I don't know what happened, but there's a big interest in shipping because the world aboard the ship is very exotic to people ashore. So even though I put a picture, no matter what it is, if it's the same sunset every day, people find it very interesting because it's so far away and so different to their normal life. And it's easy for me to just go out and take a nice photo of the sea and the ship, where it is more difficult for people who work in an office to make an interesting photo every day. So it's an easy trick for me, so to say.
But do you find it demanding to be that star on Instagram for the maritime industry?
What do you mean by demanding?
I mean, do you feel the pressure? Is there a pressure for you to deliver not sunsets, but interesting pictures from all over?
Yes, a little bit, because when I'm ashore, I cannot produce the same nice pictures. And then people, they ask for me, where are you? What are you doing? So in that sense. But then I have a little trick, because fortunately, there are so many ship spotters around the world who follows my vessel, even though I'm not on board. So they keep sending me pictures of my ship, even though I'm not there. So I can, in fact, post a little bit, even though I'm not on board. But don't tell anyone.
I will not tell anyone. But I've also seen your photos of when you are in Copenhagen and when you're attending meetings and you are going to board meeting. I mean, you're a member of the board.
Yes, I'm an employee elected member of the board in Maersk, yes. So, yeah, I do post pictures relevant to my job and to my captain role, I would say, because that's also what people find interesting. And I would also like to show that, because that's also part of my job. And before, I used to show more of my private life also, but I have downscaled that a little bit, because that on the internet, that can often have a little backside.
Yeah, it's a difference between being personal and being private.
Yes, exactly.
So maybe you should say the account, the name of the account, because I know that you have had problems with the copycats.
Yes, I do. And it has really been a big problem and still is. And that is because when people see a photo of a mid-aged captain with a grayish beard, and then they see the Maersk star in the background, they trust that photo. And unfortunately, that has been used for scammers and fake profiles. to trick people. That is the backside of the social media and having a lot of scammers and attention. But I've managed to live with it, and then I've kind of taken away a little bit of my private life from the social media.
So your account is Captain Thomas underscore official, isn't it?
Yes.
Because I keep blocking and reporting all these scammers. I see them all over the place, but I know who you are and
yes.
I know your account, so I am blocking and reporting everyone else. So
yes, thank you very much.
Maybe we should ask other people to do the same thing.
There are many sweet people who are assisting and doing the same, but as quickly as you report and have them deleted, they pop up again. So it's almost a waste of time, and people don't understand why it is happening, but it is organized crime happening from some internet cafes in some foreign countries, and it's all about money and tricking people's money out of people. Just ignore, block, don't spend too much time on it. We cannot do anything about it. I have learned to accept that.
Okay, because I have felt sorry for you. I should stop that as well then.
Yeah, but don't feel that anymore. It's okay. I can only try to imagine what famous people, actors, what they have to live up to or manage.
How do you think that we could make our industry more visible? I mean, you are doing such a great job, and so are others, but how can we become more visible to the general public?
Yeah, what we are doing now on the internet and social media, yes, that's of course a way, but there should be more people should know where the goods in the supermarket are coming from. They know where their products are coming from. Milk is coming from a cow and the egg is coming from the hen and all that stuff. But where do the jeans and where do the sneakers come from? So more visibility, and I would say it cannot be too much, because for many, many years, I would say almost until now, we have lived under the radar for people ashore. The physical distance have been so far away. And even though, for instance, in Denmark, we are a big maritime nation, but through the Danish belt, there are thousands of ships passing every day, but you don't see them. And you don't see the goods they are transporting, even though they're just outside some of our windows. So I hope that if something good should come out of this pandemic, then that people are getting more aware how important the shipping industry is.
Yeah, because I think that was part of the problem once we started to try and get the seafarers become key workers. I mean,
yes. And so far, seafarers have been very humble and just wanting to do a good job, then go home and spend vacation. And of course, we are proud, but we are also humble and just want to do our job. But I think that a little more appreciation would be okay.
Yeah.
In some aspects.
You need to claim it.
Yeah. So we need to speak up and just don't have to scream and shout, but just show that we are here and what we are doing.
Did you have a role model growing up?
I did have an uncle and an aunt who did very well in business and did a lot of traveling and who also loved sailing. And I really looked up to them and wanted to be like them someday and be able to see the world and do good in business. And they did a different business, but yeah, now I have my own business, so to say. So yes, I guess they were my role models. I didn't think of it that way before, but yes.
Do you consider yourself a role model now?
Yes and no. I am aware that some see me as a role model, and I know that it comes with the responsibility. What I do and what I say and how I do things. So and there are sweet young people who write to me every day and tell me that I am. So there must be something about it. I'm happy about that.
I think you're a role model, if that counts.
Yeah, thank you very much, Lena. Thank you. No, but I would like to show especially the young people that it is possible to have a good life, even though you have to leave your family and friends for a long time. An exciting career, exciting professional lives with a lot of opportunities, challenges, but you will grow from it. And you can do it no matter where you come from, because it's an international business. And whether you're a man or a woman, you can be successful. And other, even religion or sexuality, or I am gay, I'm married to a man. So I would also like to show young people from all over the world that don't be afraid. You can make it. You can become a captain. You can even become a board member in Maersk. Do not be afraid. It is possible. And that I would like to tell the young people.
Thank you. Thank you. I think that was really what I want with my podcast, to show young people that it's possible. So many things is possible if you just dare to do something.
Yes. It can be scary to jump and do it, but you will land on your feet.
So who do you think I should interview the next? Who would you be interested in listening to in the shipping podcast?
The first person that I don't know much about yet, but is quite interesting, I would think, and that is Bo Simonsen, who is now the CEO of this new decarbonization center, the Maersk Mc-Kinney Møller Center for Decarbonization. And that is because I don't know much about it. I've met him, but I would like to learn more about it.
Good. That is exactly what happens to me. I learn so much from the guests I have, and it's a privilege for me to be putting the questions more or less that I want to people. And people are kind enough just to answer and enriching me and my listeners, I think.
Yes. Good.
Thank you for taking the time to speak to me, Thomas.
It was my pleasure, Lena, and I'm honored that you would have me.
Thank you, Thomas. I'm so happy that we had the chance to exchange ideas. It's interesting to hear that you say that the biggest change in your career at sea is the internet and all the opportunities that it brings. I can only imagine that it's even more revolutionary at sea than what we on shore think it is. To highlight the crew change crisis, I would love to put together an episode of the shipping podcast with seafarers that have been stuck on board for a long time. I would like to be the sounding board for them, to let the rest of the world know about what it's been like to be on a ship through the entire pandemic. If you or someone you know would like to participate, please send me an email to hello@shippingpodcast.com, and then we will take it from there. On your side, you will have to have connectivity for a Zoom call and a headset. The rest you can leave to me. I would really appreciate if you get in touch. So, until the next time, from me to you, over and out. Thank you for listening to the Shipping Podcast. Don't forget to tell everyone that you meet that there is a Shipping Podcast available and that they should download it and listen to the maritime professionals who are sharing their passion for the shipping industry.